This is Audible Bleeding, the Vascular Surgery Podcast. We're here to help you keep your finger on the pulse.
Welcome back to another episode of Audible Bleeding. My name is Jacob Schwartzman. I am a chief resident in general surgery at Rutgers New Jersey Medical School, and I will be the incoming vascular fellow at the bi-campus New York Presbyterian Vascular Surgery Fellowship starting next year. I'm also here with Adam Johnson, one of the current first-year fellows. Today we are discussing the November JVS Editor's Choice articles, which editor-in-chief of the JVS, Dr. Peter Glavitsky. Welcome back to the podcast, Dr. Glavitsky.
Thank you, Jacob, and thank you, Adam. It is a real pleasure to be back, and congratulations to Audible Bleeding for broadcasting the latest and best information that we published in the Journal of Vascular Surgery.
Thank you for joining us. So let's jump right into it. The first paper for discussion is a retrospective nationwide German registry-based analysis performed by Dr. Santelas and colleagues titled Last Neurologic Event is Associated with Risk of In-Hospital Stroke or Death After Carotid Endarterectomy or Carotid Artery Stenting, Secondary Analysis of the German Statutory Quality Assurance Database. The database is the AQUA Institute dataset, which captures all carotid endarterectomies and stenting procedures performed in Germany by mandate. The study includes 144,000 carotid endarterectomies between 2009 and 2014, and 14,000 transfemoral carotid stenting procedures performed between 2012 and 2014. Neurologic events in increasing order of severity were asymptomatic patients, amaurosis fugax, TIA, minor stroke, which is Rankin scale between 0 and 2, major stroke, which is Rankin scale between 3 and 5, crescendo TIAs, and stroke and evolution. On multivariable modeling, the study found that the postoperative death and stroke rate were independently and strongly associated with the severity of the neurologic event. So more severe events had poorer outcomes prior to the intervention. Asymptomatic patients and patients with amaurosis fugax of note were noted to have similar rates of postoperative events for patients undergoing both interventions. So a few questions for you, Dr. Glavitsky. The first one, how can clinicians incorporate these findings into their daily practice?
Well, thank you, Jacob, for your excellent summary of this paper, which I think is an important paper because it is a real-world experience of a large number of patients who underwent carotid endarterectomy or stenting. The important message is, as you said, that asymptomatic patients seem to have the same early outcome than those patients who have symptoms but only present with amaurosis fugax, which is obviously transient monocular blindness. This is a very important message because many of the studies that have been done on symptomatic patients included amaurosis fugax. And obviously, what we learned from this paper that not all symptomatic patients are equal. There have been previous publications in the JVS, the Society for Vascular Surgery Registry, or the VQI study that actually showed similar findings that patients with amaurosis fugax do much better than those symptomatic patients who have TIAs or minor or major stroke. So I think this is the most important finding is in this study.
As a surgeon in practice, is there any way that this would maybe change how you counsel patients regarding their perioperative risk?
The perioperative risk obviously is very important, especially in asymptomatic patients, because it is hard to recommend a procedure that has any significant early risk when medical treatment has practically no early risk. As far as the data from this study are concerned, it is important to note that these are in-hospital early results and not 30-day early results. We know that not all complications after a carotid procedure happen immediately after the operation. In fact, only about half of them occur immediately. And many of these complications actually occur later, some of them within a week. About 80% of the complications occur within a week, and then the remaining within 1 month. So when I read this paper, I really liked the low complication rate. I like the low stroke death rate, but I also noticed that this paper, in fact, reports in-hospital outcomes. So when we counsel our patients, most of the time, actually, we tell them about stroke and death risk within 30 days. And as we know, in the current guidelines of the Society for Vascular Surgery, it is 3% for asymptomatic disease and 6% for symptomatic patients. So I don't think that other than the importance that if the patient only had amaurosis fugax, then the risk will be that of an asymptomatic patient. I think that is to be the main message of this paper. And I would rather rely on that and not quoting my patients the absolute numbers of complications.
Thank you. That's very helpful. One last thing about this paper. Notably, it doesn't include any patients who have had a TCAR procedure. I'm wondering, do you anticipate that the advent of TCAR may change the observed results in the years to come if such a study were to be repeated again?
Well, TCAR is an emerging new procedure. The data are very exciting. It appears that the data are likely better than the result of transfemoral carotid artery stenting. I think at this point, I would be cautious and I would wait on later results. I would love to see comparative studies with carotid endarterectomy. But based on what I have seen so far, I believe that TCAR in selected patients with appropriate anatomy has a chance to duplicate results of surgical carotid endarterectomy.
Well, that's great. Thanks, Dr. Glavitsky, for a great summary of the first paper. We just want to make sure that the listeners know of note that this is the editor's choice, and then also there's CME activities associated with this paper that are available through the JVS. So hope everyone goes out and downloads this one. It's now, of course, free for the month of November and reads through this great paper. So we'll move on to our second paper, which is from Dr. Mark Farber and colleagues, and is titled Results from a Prospective Multicenter Feasibility Study of the Zenith P Branch Stent Graft. The authors provide the results of 30 patients who underwent repair of compatible paravisceral abdominal aortic aneurysms with the off-the-shelf Zenith P Branch Stent Graft between 2013 and 2015. The P Branch Stent Graft is an off-the-shelf graft by Cook with two pivot renal fenestrations, an SMA fenestration, and a scallop for the celiac artery. They found technical success and to be 93% and no short-term mortality, renal failure, or mesenteric ischemia, which supports the safe use of this new device. We actually had one of the authors, Dr. Oderich, on to discuss branched and fenestrated devices earlier this year, and we recommend any listeners who want to learn more about this topic to go back and to listen to that episode. So Dr. Glavitsky, you know, how does this device fit into the context of available devices for how we manage paravisceral and really complex abdominal aortic aneurysms?
Well, I think that this device has been a clear progress since the CFEN device was approved by the FDA. I think everybody would love to have an off-shelf device for patients who have a difficult neck, a short neck, or an anatomy that does not make the aneurysm suitable for standard endovascular repair. And indeed, the P branch is a clear progress. It is immediately available, but it also has limitation of anatomy. I think this paper is obviously important. It brings us short-term, relatively short-term results, two-year results in a small group of patients, 30 patients that underwent this procedure during more than 2 years of enrollment with the participation of multiple centers. So the technical success was excellent. It was 93%. The results were excellent with a 0% 30-day mortality, 0% paraplegia, no patient on dialysis. The two-year results showed some problems with renal artery patency. The patency was 88%. I think there is clearly a need for a device, especially in those patients who cannot wait 4 to 6 weeks for a device that is custom made for the patient. So I think this device is again increases the number of patients who cannot undergo conventional EVAR or cannot undergo conventional EVAR safely. We know that there are at least 40% of abdominal aortic aneurysm patients who cannot undergo conventional EVAR either because they have a neck that's less than 10 millimeter in size, or they have thrombus or calcification or involvement of the visceral arteries. So the way I see it, this device fills a gap. I am sure that there will be further modifications. And ultimately, once we have the longer-term result, this device is going to find its place in the armamentarium of, treatment of complex aortic aneurysms.
So you touched on this a little bit, but what are the next steps for a device like this before it can really be widely available to all clinicians, just to give a little context to how these new devices come to market?
Obviously, these are still small number of patients. And as I mentioned, the follow-up is 2 years. So I'm sure that we will need longer term follow-up with these patients. I think ultimately the way I see it is this device will be approved. There have been already some early modification in the device design, but I think ultimately we will have an off-shelf device that's FDA approved. And again, that it will be suitable for a certain number of patients.
Dr. Glavitsky, thank you very much for that. It's very helpful for early trainees, especially someone like me, to hear more about these devices that are coming to market. With that in mind, let's jump into the third paper. This is a paper by Dr. Douglas Jones and colleagues, and is a retrospective registry-based analysis titled Differences in Patient Selection and Outcomes Based on Abdominal Aortic Aneurysm Diameter Thresholds in the Vascular Quality Initiative. They studied just under 23,000 elective endovascular aortic aneurysm repairs performed between 2003 and 2017 and linked these patients with the Social Security Death Index to identify mortality at 5 years. 41% of the procedures were performed for small aneurysms, defined as less than 5.5 centimeters in men and less than 5 centimeters in women. 47% were performed for medium aneurysms, and only 12% were performed for large aneurysms, defined as greater than 6.5 centimeters in both men and women. After attempting to adjust for differences in baseline characteristics through a Cox regression analysis, the study found that the hazard of reintervention at 1 year follow-up and the hazard of death at 5 years follow-up were significantly higher with increasing aneurysm size. So can you start off by giving us some thoughts? What is the most impactful finding of this study?
The most important finding is that indeed patients who have a smaller aneurysm are anatomically more suitable for endovascular repair, but also very likely these patients also have less comorbidities and overall do well. So the main message of this paper that if a patient is fit for surgery, then it is better to repair the aneurysm under 6 centimeter in size, certainly, and not wait until it develops further. So it kind of makes common sense. But in the same time, obviously, this paper doesn't tell us that we should repair small aneurysms. So the paper has an important message, but we also all, when we read this paper, we have to be very critical and we have to remember that aneurysm size, that is so important to indicate repair, greatly determines the indication, and small aneurysms rarely rupture.
This sort of follows along with what you were just talking about, but do you find it at all striking that such a high proportion of patients with small aneurysms are undergoing endovascular repair early?
It is interesting that you say that, because I thought, I said, God, 40% of these patients undergo repair of small abdominal aortic aneurysm. And then I looked up our paper that we published from the Mayo Clinic experience just 2 years ago with Dr. Huang and myself as the primary authors, and the numbers are exactly the same. 42% of the patients in the Mayo Clinic series had an aneurysm less than 5.5 centimeter in size. And you are wondering how come that there are so many patients. Obviously, most of these are between 5 and 5.5 centimeter, but how come that there are so many small aneurysms repaired in this country? And I think there is an explanation for it, in a way that clearly women should have aneurysms repaired with a smaller size, that aneurysms that grow rapidly, certainly those that grow more than 1 centimeter per year, should be repaired small, that saccular aneurysm should be repaired practically whenever it's diagnosed, but certainly those saccular aneurysms that are greater than 4.5 centimeter in size should be repaired. And then the issue of surveillance comes in. Surveillance is recommended by the aneurysm guidelines, the SVS guidelines, in patients with small aneurysms. But the question is the patient going to undergo a surveillance? And we know that the risk of rupture is so much higher in patients who do not follow the recommended surveillance regimen. So I think there are multiple issues that are considered, or there are multiple reasons why small aneurysms are repaired. And we almost have to look at each case in a case-by-case basis. But it is a little bit sobering that there is such a high percentage of aneurysms that are repaired under the threshold that's recommended by SVS guidelines.
So if I may, I'd like to ask you to speculate a little bit. Why do you think this may be the case? Is there some mechanism for the differences in outcomes between aorta size in these patients? Or maybe are there some underlying comorbidities that we're not controlling for, or some degree of sickness that we're just not capturing in these patients who have larger aneurysms?
Well, I think you just mentioned a few reasons. Clearly, smaller aneurysms have a better anatomy. Clearly, patients who have smaller aneurysms are presumably younger patients with less comorbidities. Sometimes small aneurysms are repaired because they have a larger associated iliac artery aneurysms. So there can be a lot of reasons. Saccular aneurysms, those are excellent anatomies for endovascular repair. And now there are multiple studies, including our study, and this large study by Dr. Jones also proves that indeed the smaller aneurysms, or patients with smaller aneurysms, do better. It is important to read actually the editorial of the November issue of the JVS that will discuss a little bit the conundrum of managing small abdominal aortic aneurysm. We ask Matthew Mell from Sacramento to write this editorial, and very wisely, Dr. Mell emphasizes the strict need to adhere to surveillance, because otherwise patients who have small aneurysm but who are lost to follow-up will have a 6 times more likely presentation with a rupture. If we recommend surveillance to our patients and send the patient home, we better be sure that those patients will come back for follow-up.
I think that's a great point, Dr. Glavitsky, and I think it's also something for the trainees to acknowledge, though, that EVAR doesn't remove that need for the follow-up, because if they do get an EVAR, they still need to follow up with imaging. So with either arm, either observation or with EVAR, there's still that follow-up and surveillance component.
I think that's an excellent point.
All right. So we'll transition to our final paper by Flores and colleagues, which is a prospective single institution pre- and post-intervention analysis titled Benefit of Multidisciplinary Wound Care Center on the Volume and Outcomes of a Vascular Surgery Practice. They analyzed changes in case volumes, surgical indications, procedural characteristics, and outcomes, including freedom from amputation in patients undergoing revascularization, amputation, or wound debridements for 735 patients treated prior and 1,500 patients treated after initiating a multidisciplinary wound clinic. They found an increase in volume of wound debridements and infrapopliteal endovascular interventions and a reduction in the rates and risk of major amputation, 5.5 from 8.8%, but no difference in all-cause mortality. We actually had Dr. Chandra as well on the podcast, who's the lead author on this, and she spoke a little about the work at Stanford and the work that they put into establishing this multidisciplinary wound care clinic. So would, again, refer listeners back to that episode if they want to hear more. So Dr. Glavitsky, with the increasing data coming out about these multidisciplinary wound care clinics, what value do they bring to a busy vascular surgery practice?
We selected this paper because it clearly shows the benefit of a multidisciplinary vascular center and the benefit for the vascular surgery practice and the benefit for the patients, of course. It increases the lower extremity interventions, and it increased it by 64%. In this study of Dr. Flores and Dr. Chandra, but it also resulted in a significant decrease in major amputation rate, which is very important because the 5-year mortality after a major amputation can be, in this patient population, can be as high as 70%. So to decrease the 1-year major amputation rate from 8.8 to 5.5%, that is substantial. It also showed that it increased the endovascular intervention, particularly the infrapopliteal endovascular interventions of the surgical group. So altogether, I think this is just another paper that supports multidisciplinary management of patients with chronic limb-threatening ischemia, especially those patients who are diabetic or have chronic renal disease.
So would you venture to say that it's a standard of care for a limb salvage patient to be managed in one of these multidisciplinary wound care clinics?
It certainly is becoming the standard of care. We have seen that the number of dedicated wound care centers have greatly increased in the last 2 decades. The number I remember is that since 2000, 1,500 dedicated wound care centers opened across the United States. It is not by chance that it is underlined, emphasized, and recommended in the global guidelines at every level. In a way, it can be a basic wound care center, it can be a hospital-based, or like in this case, an outpatient multidisciplinary center, or with all necessary specialties involved, it can be a center of excellence. So I strongly encourage everybody to read the appropriate section of the global guidelines that we published in the Journal of Vascular Surgery on chronic limb-threatening ischemia that not only emphasizes the advantages, but it also lists the necessary requirements for these centers, especially of the multidisciplinary centers and the centers of excellence.
Dr. Glavitsky, thank you very much for your time and for sharing your expertise with all of us. We really appreciate it, and we look forward to having you back on the podcast again soon.
Thank you very much, Jacob and Adam.
We are Audible Bleeding. We'd like to remind our listeners to please fill out our listener survey so that we can learn more about you and improve our podcast. We'd like to thank Dr. Shamim Kuhn Hamid for his generous donation. Thanks for the support, and everyone, thanks for listening.